Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala nabiyyihi wa mustafah wa ba'd. Brothers and sisters, welcome to another live edition of your program, Ask Huda. Our phone numbers beginning with the area code are 00202385131 or 132, the last three digits. And the Facebook page is Dr. Muhammad Salah Official. We'll be more than happy to start collecting your calls and concerns. May Allah guide us to what is best and enable us to deliver the right answer. Allahumma ameen. Meanwhile, I have a long list of questions that I received on the page. I will begin by tackling some of them. Rahid Khan says, Milana Faisal says, in her question, what is the Islamic ruling for a would-be groom to give gold to a would-be bride? Is this acceptable in Islam as an engagement gift? Yes, it is acceptable in Islam, provided it is best to remove any to be confusion or would be a confusion in the future for innocence. There is a difference between a gift that a fiancé gives to his fiancé, which is permissible, and something that the person may give as a part of the dowry. I mean, in the engagement, which we stated before, that it does not make any lawful unlawful, nor does it make any unlawful lawful, which means that any party of the couple has the right to separate without even explaining reasons, because there is no commitment whatsoever. An engagement would not make this person like a husband to her, not make that woman like a wife to him. No, it's a mere promise to get married. And that's why we emphasize the fact that it is not permissible for the fiancé to kiss or to touch his fiancé or her fiancé, or to go out with him or to stay alone with him, because they are not still married. They are not yet married. So based on that fact, if the engagement is resolved for a reason or another, whether it was the girl or her family or the groom or his family who decided to resolve this engagement, then if it is something valuable and the person who paid the gift asked back for it, it should be given back to him or to her. I'm assuming that there could be exchanging gifts, not necessarily only the groom or the boy, he will be given the gift or the gold. Let's say that it was the girl's family, and now they wanted their gold back. This is what you stated. It's definitely the right to ask for it back. There is a difference between this condition and another condition where the person would pay whatever he would pay with the intention of paying it as a dowry. After processing the marriage contract and before consummating the marriage, before ad-dukhul, if the man paid this jewelry or this gold or diamond ring as a part of the dowry or as the whole dowry, then before consummating the marriage, they decided to resolve this marriage relationship. Is it permissible? It is permissible. And in this case, the divorce will be ba'in, irreversible, unlike after consummating the marriage. And half of the dowry will be due, and it will be the right of the bride. That is because it was before consummating the marriage. So the other half is his right, whether resolving the marriage was from his side or her side. But before the marriage contract and during engagement, everyone should collect all their gifts, especially the valuable ones, which are still there. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Abu Naifa from Nigeria, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi ya Sheikh.
How are you, brother? Welcome to the program.
I'm fine, thank you very much. And you, Sheikh?
Just fine, alhamdulillah. Miss you guys in Nigeria. Go ahead.
We miss you too, yeah, Sheikh.
Inshallah, we'll be coming soon. What is your question today?
Mashallah, hope to see you soon.
Thank you.
Yeah. Please, I want to ask on male child circumcision.
What is the question again?
Yeah, male child circumcision. Is it supposed to be done 7 days after birth or after 7 years?
Okay. That is something basically the pediatrician or the surgeon would determine what is the best age and also the best time, because sometimes a child is very weak, some kids are born with jaundice, some kids are born under age, underweight. So basically the doctor determines that, okay? It is not something that you have to do it on a particular date. I hope you got my answer. Barakallahu feek. We answer Milana's question, then Rahid Khan. Rahid says in his question, I hope it is he, or if it is she, Allah knows best, is it haram to watch pirated video lectures, which are already many other students having and using? Before answering with yes or no, I would like to clarify a very important fact, which states that Islam protects the personal property and orders all Muslims to respect the personal property of all human beings, Muslims and non-Muslims. So if somebody has a personal property, whether in the form of a property or cash or even ideas, you know, or somebody authored a book or invented something, we should respect the personal property of this person. Somebody delivered a series of lectures and he is selling them or authored a book and he's not allowing anyone to publish them or to give them for free. That is his choice. He doesn't want any reward. He is doing this solely for the sake of business. So it is not permitted to pirate these products and to resell them. That's absolutely forbidden. To pirate them, then copy them and resell them. Because now it is stealing the income of somebody else. But the case is different if the person is a student, if the person is a seeker of knowledge, if the person cannot afford the means and it is already there. So he would only watch them, but not copy them to resell them to make an income out of that. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Muhammad from Nigeria, assalamu alaikum. Okay, please try again, Muhammad, no problem. Nabil Anwar, that must be he. His question is, my class starts before Maghrib prayer, and it ends after Maghrib. And like this, I cannot pray Maghrib on time. I try to go in between my classes, but I can't do it, and there is no break in between. What should I do in this matter? The time for Aisha starts at 7 p.m. My class sometimes finishes at 6:50. Can I pray Maghrib just before 7 p.m.? Will that count? Now, I wish all the audience would pay attention to this question and to its answer. I understand that some audience do watch the program in order to get an answer for a specific question that they deliver, or maybe a question that is delivered and it is interesting to them. So I want to summarize the question before I give the answer. Let me take this call first and I will be back with the question, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Ahmed from Bahrain.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the program. Ahlan wa sahlan.
Thank you very much, Sheikh. My daughter she's 8 years old. She has a question. She asked me, when non-Muslim kids die, so where they will go? They will be in a Jannah, or what their destiny for them? So that is a just question for my daughter, from my daughter and Muslim.
Okay.
On behalf of my daughter.
Okay. Got your question.
Only this question.
Okay. Right. Thank you, Ahmed. Let me tackle the earlier question, which I shared with you first, Nabil's question, then I will get back to Ahmed's question. So basically, all of us sometimes we are put in a similar situation and typical circumstances. Whether you are a student, whether you are a teacher, whether you are a doctor operating on a patient, you know. His question is, my class before Maghrib starts and it ends almost at Isha time or a few minutes before Isha time. What am I supposed to do? And is this a necessity that allows me to combine the two prayers, Maghrib and Isha, obviously at the time of Isha, because the class begins before Maghrib? Let's see. According to the sound collection of Al-Imam Muslim, Abdullah ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, narrated that on one day in Al-Madina, in the city of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, combined Dhuhr and Asr together. Then he combined Maghrib and Isha together without fear or heavy rain. Why did he state that? Because it is understood that whenever there is a heavy rain, whenever there is a hurricane, whenever there is a natural disaster, whenever it is snowing, you don't have to go to the masjid for every prayer. Simply you can pray Asr along with Dhuhr, and that's it. And you can go back whenever the Imam or the masjid announces that we will postpone Maghrib and Isha together to be prayed at the time of Isha, or we will pray Isha along with Maghrib immediately after we pray Maghrib, and the Isha will be four rak'ahs. That is definitely permissible. But the hadith that Abdullah ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, narrated, he said, "Fi ghayri khawfin wala matar," without any of these, you know, common valid excuses. There was no fear, no heavy rain. So Abdullah ibn Abbas commented on that by saying, he wanted to an yarfa' al-haraja an ummatih, to lift the burden from about his ummah. What does it mean? Let me explain this. Assalamu alaikum. Akhi Muhammad from the KSA, thank you for waiting. Go ahead.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I want to know, nowadays everybody is using credit card, and some of my family members use the credit card. And once I got the information from Huda TV that it is like fighting with the war with the Prophet and Allah. So I talked to them and tried to settle their debts. So I took their card and I'm paying them. But I cannot pay the complete thing in one shot.
Mm.
So I am doing it. We're doing maximum amount, and so that they can be clear from that one, and they can save from this one. So this is a good one, or shall I do it, or shall I stop it?
MashaAllah, Muhammad. Akhi Muhammad, that's very nice of you. MashaAllah, I wish I was a family member of yours. Jazakallah khairan. Okay, I will answer your question, inshallah, but I have to wrap it up first with an earlier question. But, you know, I got your question. I got your point.
As I said.
Thank you. Jazakallah khair. Brother Uthman from Nigeria. Uthman, assalamu alaikum. Okay, it seems like we don't have luck with the Nigerian calls today. Okay, please try again. So Abdullah ibn Abbas says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam one day prayed Dhuhr and Asr together, four rak'ahs each, combined, at the time of either one of them. Then he came in Maghrib and he prayed Maghrib and Isha together. And Isha he prayed four rak'ahs. So it was not for rain or for the cause of fear or any of these legitimate reasons. He said, أراد أن يرفع الحرج عن أمته. He wanted to give ease to his ummah. What does it mean that أراد أن يرفع الحرج عن أمته? There are certain circumstances which are besides fear, besides heavy rain, besides natural disasters. Sometimes somebody is sick. Somebody is having, hard time to make wudu for each prayer. So he combines two prayers. He has sickness that does prevent him from, going to the bathroom back and forth and making wudu, and he has to do that. So Allah the Almighty gave him ease, and the Prophet ﷺ deliberately did so in order to give him an ease. Does this case fit here? Also, the opinion of the vast majority of the Muslim jurists are of the view that Al-Jam'a here, the combination of the two prayers, is not literal, like praying two prayers at the time of either one. No, rather, he prayed Dhuhr a few minutes before the Asr Adhan has been called. And he delayed Maghrib until a couple minutes or a few minutes before the Isha. So this is how they explain it. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Omar from Turkey.
Yes.
Assalamu alaikum, Omar.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Nasasin.
Yim abi. I'm actually from Nigeria, but I'm calling from Turkey.
Okay, you know good Turkish. MashaAllah, go ahead.
Yeah. Shwaya, shwaya.
Okay. And Arabic too.
Yeah, little. So, my question goes like this, Sheikh Yashet. Hello?
I'm listening, go ahead.
Okay, my question is about dua.
Yeah?
When some I read 1,500 on Riyadu Salihin that talk about best time of making dua, which is the middle of the night and after compulsory prayer.
Mm.
So my question, where I want to give a point, you said, because I listened to most of your program where you talk about making dua after prayer, that it's more accepted inside the prayer, you should do it when you are on sujood.
Mm-hmm.
So now, but the hadith is talking about the best time of prayer is after composite prayer. So I want you to give more light about this hadith, what it means by after compulsory prayer.
Okay.
Because it contradicts some things I heard from you, Sheikh.
Okay.
My second question goes like this again. My second question is more of contribution. There is this thing going on, be it mostly on social media. People like, especially from the girls, using nickname, maybe someone, her name is Fatima, she will use Bint Rasul. Or someone, the girl's name is Amina, she will use Umul Rasul as her nickname. Mm. They use it as username. Is that accepted or not?
Okay. Thank you, Omar. We got a call from Nigeria. It went through because the caller is calling from Turkey. Okay, assalamu alaikum. Uthman from Nigeria. Assalamu alaikum, Uthman.
Wa alaikum assalam, ya Sheikh.
Go ahead.
Wa alaikum assalam, ya Sheikh. My own case is not a question, actually. Is that I actually need an advice. I actually happen to be one who listens to music on daily basis. I try to get as much as possible to get rid of this habit, but I don't know why it's not working. I just need an advice.
Akhi Uthman. Uthman.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead and ask the advice that you wanted. You need to mute your TV as well.
Okay. Yeah, Sheikh, my question happens to be my advice.
I won't be able to take your question unless if you mute your TV, Akhi Uthman. Okay. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Abu Bakr from Nigeria.
Hello.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam, ya Sheikh.
Mm-hmm. Welcome to the program, Abu Bakr. Go ahead.
Yeah, my question is that we have a baby that is 9 months old, and then the wife has a 2 week pregnancy. The question now is what is the ruling on aborting 2 week pregnancy, 2 week old?
Okay. Got your question. Thank you. Abu Bakr from Nigeria. Okay. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Ali from the KSA. Okay. Brother Ali's call is cut off. We have Sister Alia, though, from the KSA.
Yeah, Walaikum Assalam, Alhamdulillah, Barakatuhu, Sheikh. I have one question.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, from last 2 months, a thing is happening with me. It's related to my menstruation. That my menstruation cycle is used to be of 6 to 7 days. So what's happening with me is by the 6th day, there is no discharge at all.
Mm.
Then I do ghusl. It happens twice, the last to last month and last month also. Then after 6 months, there is no discharge for the whole day. So I used to do my ghusl and start praying. But after I do ghusl and start praying, then there is sudden yellowish, or you can say pale reddish type of discharge.
Mm.
Then I again have to do my ghusl and I have to start praying again. So my doubt is, I have already done the ghusl earlier and started praying. But then these things happen and I used to do my ghusl again. So what about my prayer which I prayed earlier? And what should be I doing in such a case? Is the second ghusl is also required? Because I'm not sure what is the second discharge about.
Okay.
Because it's immediate after my menstruation, only about after 1 day or 2 days.
Okay.
It's immediately after that. So I'm not sure, is it a part of my menstruation or what?
Just one question, Sister Alia. How long is it normally, in normal days, in normal months, 6 days, 7 days, 8 days, how long is it? Can you hear me?
Yeah, it's 6 or 7 days only.
7 days.
Yeah, so if I got your question. 6 day, I used to do ghusl on 6 day.
Okay.
But then on 7 day, there is some discharge.
Okay. I got your question. Barakallah feek. Thank you. Sister Raihana from the KSA, Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Sheikh Salah, I have 2-3 questions today.
Go ahead.
My first question is regarding the hadith of Bukhari. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told that urine and milk of camel has shifa. It is the hadith of Bukhari. But one of my friend is arguing with me and is telling me that it was for the camel herder. They killed the herder and then later on the Muslims executed them only for that particular group of people. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told to drink, and the real meaning of this hadith is that if a person needs to consume an impure and impermissible substance as a cure for an illness, and no other reasonable alternative is available, then only it is permissible. In other circumstances, camel's urine is prohibited. So,
Could you please ask him, where did he get this understanding from?
Well, yeah, just to tell by themselves, I think, sir, because they don't give me any reference, they don't give me any proof. They are asking me to give the proof whether the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, while during his lifetime, did he sallallahu alaihi wasallam drank it or not. They are asking me, but I don't have any proof that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam drank it. But I know this is a hadith, sound hadith from Bukhari, that he sallallahu alaihi wasallam told it is cure. So they are asking.
Got it, Sister Rahana. I just need to say, what you need to present to them or throw at them, two things. First of all, whenever any person gives an interpretation of an ayah or a hadith, ask him or her based on what? Where did he get this understanding from? If he or she said, that's my personal understanding, okay, thank you, keep it for yourself. Okay? The hadith doesn't say you have to do that. It's similar to the hadith that if a fly happens to drop in your drink, when the Prophet ﷺ says, dip it, three times, then throw it away and you can drink. He says, if you want to drink it, you can drink it because now it's okay. Not before that. You know, when somebody gets stuck and he says, oh, this is awful, this is disgusting, this is whatever, you don't understand, you don't get the point. You're lacking wisdom. And it doesn't say you have to, but it says there is a cure in it. Cupping is a cure. The Prophet ﷺ says so. So if you want to do it, fine. If you want to seek the cure in it, fine. If you're not happy with it, do not say, since I'm a doctor, I think this is, this is not true. Keep your information for yourself. We believe in the sound sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Especially these are things which the Prophet ﷺ recommended for certain situations. He does not say, rather, you have to do it. Okay? You said you have a couple questions. Raihan, we'll take your two more questions, inshallah, if you call us back. Assalamu alaikum. Aisha from Nigeria. Assalamu alaikum, Sister Aisha. Assalamu alaikum. Okay.
So, is it allowed if a person is suffering from depression and anxiety and fear? Is it allowed to use movies to treat them?
Movies?
Yeah.
To treat an anxiety?
Fear and depression in hospitals.
Okay. Got your question. Any other questions?
No, thank you, Sheikh.
Well, thank you, Sister Aisha from Nigeria. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Muhammad from the KSA.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. How are you?
Alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm fine. Thank you, Brother Muhammad. How about yourself?
Thank you, Sheikh. Thank you. Sheikh, I have a question. I am actually from Kerala, India. But according to my understanding, there are some of the ulamas, sheikhs, they claim that they have the hair belongs to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They got from somewhere part of the world. What they made is they brought in Kerala. They made a big mosque which is having around $50 million US dollars or something. They made a big mosque, and what they are doing is this hair they are putting in the water, and the water they are giving to the people for money. And this is happening, and this is a big business over there. Many people, Muslim so-called claims, they are going there and there. But I am a little bit confused whether, I know that this is a little bit, but they are saying this is the actual Prophet's hair. But can you just put light on that, Sheikh?
Okay. Got your question, Brother Muhammad. Before we go for a break, let's put a hold on the calls for now to finish the question about the exam, the class, and missing the Maghrib prayer. So I said, the vast majority of the jurists are of the view that the explanation of combining the prayers on that day, as narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas, is not the literal jama'ah. Rather, that he would delay the prayer until the last few minutes of its time, before the beginning of the following prayer. Is this valid? It is valid, especially in cases like that. He said, you finish your class at 6:50. Can I pray Maghrib 10 minutes before Isha? It is valid. We have the ideal way to offer the prayer on its fixed time, at the earliest time, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was asked about the best deed. In one narration he said, As-salatu ala waqtiha, only waqtiha, which means to pray on time. In another narration, in the beginning of its time, so the earlier is the better. But in cases like that, it is permissible to postpone the prayer, especially there is no masjid around you, you're praying by yourself, perhaps you're studying in a class, in a community, where you're the only Muslim. Let's say that there are many Muslims along with you. Soon after the class, you can establish the jama'ah immediately. Postponing the prayer until the last time, but before the time of the following prayer has entered, is permissible in cases like that. Also, in some circumstances such as exams, when you enter the exam room, it gets very hard to say that I have to leave so that I can offer the prayer. Let's say that it's time like Maghrib and Isha where the time is very narrow. In this case, and according to the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas, it would be permissible to postpone the Maghrib and combine it with Isha for this reason, because it happens occasionally, but the class is something different that happens on daily basis, on a regular basis for the whole semester. So I would choose, if there is still time before Isha, even 10 minutes, still I can pray before Isha. But if I fear that the Isha time will enter, I will have to excuse myself, leave the class and offer the prayer. That is the best deed, to offer the prayer on its fixed time. We'll take a short break and inshallah we'll be back in a couple of minutes. Please stay tuned.
Huda TV strives to remain the premier English language Islamic channel in the world. And to do so, we need your input. Send us your thoughts, suggestions and feedback through email at feedback@hoda.tv. Huda TV is committed to helping others, so why not help Huda TV share the message of Islam worldwide? Take part in helping spread the authentic message of Islam based on the Quran and the Sunnah throughout the world by sponsoring Huda TV. Don't miss this unique opportunity to gain the reward from Allah.
This is the Deen Show.
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 Bismillah, alhamdulillah, assalamu alaikum, peace be unto you. Thank you for tuning in to another episode of the Deen Show. From time to time, we answer some of your questions. We have so many important issues that we're dealing with here on the Deen Show, and we encourage you to come back here every week. And if you don't catch us on the TV station, you can go to thedeenshow.com where all of our shows are there.
It is important for us when we look at the issue of holiday myths, that we look at the whole picture. And from the beginning of time, people worshipped the Creator in different ways. The Quran tells us in the chapter of the bee, Surah An-Nahl, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنْ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَاجْتَنِبُوا الطَّاغُوتَ.
Maryam, how are you?
Good, alhamdulillah.
Thank you for being with us on the Deen Show.
You're welcome.
So how old are you again?
I'm 8 years old.
I didn't want to get that wrong. 8 years old. And you've memorized how many juz of the Quran?
I memorized 21 juz from the Quran.
21 juz. MashaAllah.
As you know that there is no concept of clergyman in Islam.
There isn't?
There is not.
Okay.
And this idea is supposed to be very liberating. Nobody comes between you and your Creator.
Okay.
You do not need an operator. Mm-hmm. It's a direct call. So Islam rejects the whole notion of clergyman. So a sheikh, imam, is a title that is given to a person like myself. When the community feels that you're worthy of it. And it's just a title out of respect.
This is the Deen, this is the Deen Show.
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 Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. As I requested you earlier, that we'll put a hold on the phone calls until I answer some of these questions so that we'll get to cover at least those which have been asked in the previous segment. Brother Ahmed from Bahrain said that his 8 years old child is asking about the non-Muslims, the non-believers, and what will be their fate. That's entirely the knowledge of the unseen. But Allah the Almighty has informed us about this segment in the Quran. And a believer, a Muslim, should believe in every word that has been mentioned in the Quran. And because the references are many, and in tens of ayat, I will just choose one ayah of Surah Al-Bayyinah, verse number 6 of Surah al-bayyina, and al-bayyina means a clear proof, the evident proof. Allah the Almighty says, and I chose this because I bet your daughter who's 8 have read this surah, maybe have memorized the surah. Allah the Almighty says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمَ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ شَرُّ الْبَرِيَّةِ إِنَّ تَأْكِيد, a confirmation, most surely, verily, الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا, those who did not believe, مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ, whether of the people of the book, those who rejected the message of Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, والمشركين, and those who originally associated partners to Allah in worship from other than the people of the book, في نار جهنم, will be in hellfire, خالدين فيها, خالدين, الخلود means eternity, they will abide therein forever, أولئك هم شر البرية, such people who died while disbelieving in Allah or associating partners to Allah in worship are the worst of the creatures. This is what Allah the Almighty said. There is a beautiful hadith that every Muslim should be aware of, because nowadays, with the secular programs are being presented in many TV shows, in many series, in many episodes, and our youth, our children, our wives are being victims of watching that and being poisoned with these misinformations. So this hadith is a must to share with every Muslim, and we should understand what it says. The hadith is a sound hadith, and it is collected by Imam Muslim. Let's see how the hadith explains also the previous ayah, which is very clear. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ. So he swears, he doesn't have to, but he swears to confirm the following statement. I swear to the one in whose hand is my soul, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying. لا يسمع أحد من هذه الأمة يهودي ولا نصراني ثم يموت ولم يؤمن بالذي أرسلت به إلا كان من أصحاب النار. None of those who would hear of me من هذه الأمة, anyone who lived after Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, during his life or after, يعني he had the opportunity to learn that Muhammad is the last messenger. He said, يهودي ولا نصراني, whether a Jew or Christian. Very specific. ثم يموت ولم يؤمن بي. And he dies in this condition without believing in me. Without believing that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is the last messenger of Allah. إلا كان من أصحاب النار. This is his statement. He is conveying the message to us from Allah. But he will be from amongst the dwellers of النار. May Allah protect us against that. Provided يَسْمَعُ بِي, he heard, he or she had been informed, and informed properly, because those who did not know anything about Muhammad, those who did not hear about his message, those who were not exposed to the Qur'an, for them Allah the Almighty says, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. Allah is not going to punish no one without sending a messenger. So there is a messenger, but they did not hear of him. They did not know anything about them. So what will be their fate? It's up to Allah on the Day of Judgment, whenever He will test them on that day to decide their fate. Our question is very specific. It is concerning those who deliberately chose not to believe in Allah. Those who deliberately chose to worship other than Allah, or to associate partners to Allah in worship. As He said, لا يسمع بأحد من هذه الأمة يهودي ولا نصراني ثم يموت ولم يؤمن بي إلا كان من أصحاب النار. Now, brothers and sisters, I would like to extend the answer to what about their kids? If I say it about the adults who did not know about Islam, did not know about Allah and His oneness, did not know what monotheism is, that Allah the Almighty would not immediately punish them, rather He will test them, and those who will pass the test will enter paradise, and those who will fail the test will be sent to the punishment. So the kids of the non-believers, those who die under the age of puberty, their matter is up to Allah, who will test them on the Day of Judgment. They will not be sent automatically to hell, because the ayah is very clear, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حتى نبعث رسولا. This is for the sake of time, I chose one reference, ayah number 6 of Surah Al-Bayyinah. Brother Muhammad from the KSA, the following question was about, MashaAllah, since you heard about the credit card and those who, this is his word, that those who are using the credit card will be fighting against Allah and His Messenger. Let me just fix one information that we normally say that Allah the Almighty says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَذَرُوا مَا بَقِيَ مِنَ الرِّبَى إِن كُنْتُم مُؤْمِنِينَ فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا فَأْذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. This is a condition in which Allah says that Allah and His Messenger would wage war against those who deliberately choose to deal with interest, knowingly. Okay, what about the credit card? We said the credit card which is interest-based, you don't have an asset or a balance against your spending. Basically, you're borrowing money from the bank, from the creditor, and you agree to pay interest on that, is haram. There are some exceptions where if somebody cannot live in this society without having a credit card in order to book the flight, in order to rent a car, in order to pay the bills, so the condition is haram, which is paying interest, but the person must make certain to pay the money that he charges on the card on time, even if he can pay it immediately by making a deposit to the creditor so that he would not have to pay interest. The problem is with the person who takes it easy and signs up with a credit card or with an interest-based loan. So whether the loan is through swiping your credit card and postponing the payment, and you know that you're going to be paying interest on that, or signing up an agreement with the bank to take a loan with interest. This is definitely riba. The cash that you borrow, you'll pay it back, you'll pay it off in addition to a certain percentage. Any extra payment is considered usury, is considered riba. It is absolutely forbidden, and it is one of the worst sins. There is no other sin in the Quran which Allah the Almighty declares war against the person who indulges into the sin other than dealing with riba. But we also say, Akhi Muhammad, that if the person in a financial dilemma and has no other way but to borrow with interest for an operation, for to rescue somebody or a family member, or to pay the rent, or he will be homeless, in this case you take with a limit. It is similar to eating the dead meat of a dead animal. It's haram, but to spare your life with a limit. And you understand that it is absolutely haram. Your family members who are involved in that and taking loans and not pay, and paying interest, Jazakallahu khayran. May Allah bless you a great deal for volunteering to pay their balances so that they will be debt-free, interest-free, and they will not be involved in that. Allah definitely appreciates that from you, and may Allah reward you the best. Provided that your family members or whoever you're assisting in this regard perceives this whole matter, you're doing this in order to save them from that sin, from the heinous act of dealing with riba. But if you pay it off and he goes around and he charges again, it doesn't make any sense. Okay? So you have to clarify to them and share with them perhaps the segment of what I said, that this is, you can say it is the worst sin after committing shirk, because there is no other sin in the Quran which incurs such wrath and anger from Allah to the point that he says, فَأْذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, that Allah and His Messenger declare war against you other than committing that sin. Jazakallah khairan. If you're well off and you can settle all their debts and take a word from them and a commitment, they will not deal with riba anymore. May Allah bless you. Thank you so much. Whether you will charge them back or not. Brother Umar from Turkey said he read in Riyadh al-Salihin about a dua, and the best time to make the prayer is after the fard prayer, the mandatory prayer, and in the midst of the night. Yes, absolutely. There is no confusion whatsoever. We discussed in details whenever I shared with you the hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, radiyallahu anhu, When he said that the Prophet, peace be upon him, once got hold of him and said, "O Mu'adh, I love you. لا تدعن دبر كل صلاة أن تقول اللهم أعني على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك." And I shared with you all the different views of the scholars. And in brief, the vast majority of them said that all the invocations which are mentioned in a hadith are to be recited before making taslim. That is called dubura kulli salah, by the end of every prayer. Yet I said it is also permissible to pray, to make dua after the prayer, as long as you do not make it on a regular basis or assume that it is a part of khitam salah. Because khitam salah is prescribed, and we explained it before. There is no time to go over it again. But it has been reported that the Prophet ﷺ used to recite plenty of invocations after finishing at tashahud and before making taslim, such as saying, "Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min adabin fi an-nar wa adabin fi al-qabr. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min fitnati al-mahya wal-mamat wa fitnati al-masih al-dajjal." Al-Masih al-Dajjal. These are four things that the Prophet, peace be upon him, used to seek refuge with Allah against after every prayer. And I said not only the fard and nafl prayer. Another dua, Allahumma ghfir li ma qaddamt, wa ma akhart, wa ma asrart, wa ma a'lant, wa ma anta a'lamu bihi minni. Anta al-muqaddim wa anta al-muakhir, la ilaha illa anta. And there is more though. So the ulama said to recite these invocations before making taslim. It is more sacred to recite it whether in sujood or by the end of your prayer and make it like the conclusion of your prayer. There is no confusion whatsoever. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Hussein from the KSA, assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you?
Fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
I'm very happy to talk to you, sir.
Likewise, jazakallah khairan.
I have one question.
Naam.
I want to purchase some land for some business. So I want to make some istikhara. What's the proper way to make this one?
Okay. Akhi Hussein, go ahead and pray two rak'ahs. Whether it is a sunnah after or before any prayer, sunnah ratiba, or you just pray two rak'ahs with the intention of praying istikhara. And after you finish the prayers and after making taslim, by the way, I also stated before that you can make it before taslim. But the most likely right view is after you make taslim, you finish the prayer. You send the peace and the blessings upon the Prophet ﷺ and you recite the following dua. اللهم إني أستخيرك بعلمك وأستقدرك بقدرتك وأسألك من فضلك العظيم. فإنك تقدر ولا أقدر وتعلم ولا أعلم وأنت علام الغيوب. This introduction of praising Allah, the Almighty, glorifying Him, and then asking Him to guide you through you consulting Him. اللهم إن كنت تعلم. O Allah, if you know in the knowledge of, if you're in your knowledge of the unseen, then this choice of purchasing this property with that much money is good for me in my worldly life, my worldly affairs, and in my hereafter, then make it easy for me and facilitate it for me. وَإِن كُنْتَ تَعْلَمْ. But if you know that in your knowledge, in your infinite knowledge, that this choice, buying, purchasing this property for that much money, is going to be bad for me, for my deen and dunya, then take it away from me. أَصْرُفُ عَنِّي وَصْرُفْنِي عَنْ. And take me away from it. وَقْدُرْ لِيَ الْخَيْرَ حَيْثُ كَانْ ثُمَّ رَضِّنِي بِهِ وَرَضِّنِي بِهِ. Which means, then decide or decree for me whatever is best and make me pleased with it. The dua is available in the little booklet of the Fortress of the Muslim, so that you can recite it in Arabic, if you know how to read Arabic, otherwise in your own language, after the prayer of the two rakas of istikhara. What do you expect? You expect the following, one of two things, either ease towards purchasing the property, or that you find a lot of hindrances, the deal doesn't go through, even though you're about to make the closing. Do I expect to see a dream? It's possible, but do I have to? Not necessarily. So you may see a night vision, you may not. But the outcome of al-istikhara is the comfort, the ease you find in your heart, and towards processing the business or whatever choice they consulted Allah concerning. Akhi Ammar from Turkey. Some people give their nicknames. Fatima would say Bintur Rasul, the Prophet's daughter, and somebody's name who's Amina would say Umm Rasul. That is not true. You're neither the Prophet's mother nor the Prophet's daughter. Okay, ادعوهم لآبائهم هو أقسط عند الله. So you would rather say your name or the name of your father. And I have something to share with you with regards to the Facebook or the social media, which inshallah, hopefully, I will remember to begin the next episode by discussing that. Abu Bakr from Nigeria, your wife is pregnant, 2 weeks pregnant, and you have a child who is 9 months old. I know it's tough, but when she's pregnant, there is only one reason which could legitimize the abortion or delivering the child, which is whenever it is posing a life threat to the mother. But if there is no life threat, and the physician says it's going to be hard having a child and breastfeeding another child and being pregnant, but if there is no serious threat to the mother, you cannot get rid of this embryo or the fetus in the womb of your wife. We definitely not just ran out of time, we went over time. So inshallah, allow me, Sister Alia, Sister Rayhana, Sister Aisha, and Muhammad to begin the next episode by answering your questions. Bear with me. Jazakumullahu khairan. Thank you so much for following up. May Allah accept from all of us. May Allah forgive us our sins. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the altar.